Hello, we are at Poly Canyon Village today, and since we're on campus, we're wearing our kosher PPI. This whole landscape here is mostly natives. This is a sugar bush, Rhus ovata. See if we can find, yep, there is some fruit that's forming there. And here are some buds that haven't yet come to flower. It's got alternate leaves going up with a very finely serrated margin. And the leaf color's pretty similar on the front and the back. There's a little bit of a yellow-green tinge. These plants are 25 feet tall. Very large. Then across the road here we have some sage and monkey flower.
Artemisia.
And some artemisia. So this looks like Salvia mellifera, black sage. You can tell by the scent. And this is Artemisia californica, California sagebrush from our natural hikes. And then we have Diplacus arantiacus, mimulus.
Here we are.
And this one is definitely sticky. This is does not look like a hybrid. This looks like the native variety. Some Eriogonum parviflorum. It has very fine foliage to it. Really gorgeous in bud and in flower with its umbel flowers. There's a little bit of coyote brush coming up. And yep, there's a Bacchus right there. We'll put that on your list. We'll go ahead and look at the other plants in this landscape. Here we have an assemblage of evergreen shrubs and trees. We've got a very large pine here. Below it as a screen and foundation plants along the building. We have Toyon, Heteromeles arbutifolia. You can tell it's Toyon because of these very finely branching inflorescences here that definitely stand out. This will have rose white flowers with four or five petals on them soon in the summertime. It has reddish bark on it and evenly serrated leaves that are lighter below than they are above. They're very glossy green above. And then as a brown cover here, you can see the Arctostaphylos species. I'm not sure which variety of Arctostaphylos, but it's a low growing 2 foot tall Arctostaphylos. Remember that it has the name manzanita because of these apple looking like berries. Manzanita is apple in Spanish. Here we have Rhamnia culturae, Mantellia poppy. It has these very large 4-inch, 5-inch across flowers. It's in the Papaveraceae family. And it has alternate leaves. Most Papaveraceae have this gray-green foliage that you see here. Papery, silky petals like this.
Fragrant.
Very fragrant. You can see the buds, how they open like this. It almost looks like a peony, how it's opening there. And then the other common name for this, besides Mantellia poppy, is butter and eggs.
Or I've heard it as fried egg.
Okay.
Fried egg, too.
Fried egg.
Yeah.
Maracaibo. You can see if you break off a leaf, but don't rip it in half, that there are some hairs kind of here, a third of the way down the leaf, along the mid vein. And then also how cupped the leaves are is a characteristic of agrifolia. In the background here, we've got the ground cover of some baccharis. So it's kind of a lower growing coyote brush that they found here. And then also a little field of California poppies, Eschscholzia californica. You can see that they create kind of like a grassland characteristic here next to this patio. And if you keep looking, there's a few more oaks and alders in the background. Here we have bush anemone, Carpinteria californica, and it is blowing up right now in flower. We've got bumblebees on it. You can see that its flower looks similar to a rose, but it has 6 petals. It is in the petals are also a little more reflexed or folded back, and then back they kind of do this. And it's in the Hydrangeaceae family. It has opposite leaves, and it is ranked 1B in the state of California. It only occurs east of Fresno in the Sierra foothills on the west side of the Sierras, and in these habitats there. And you can tell it really likes this north-facing building that's got good shade, that's protected from the sunlight. So I would definitely plant it in shaded habitats. And it's about 4 or 5 feet tall. It's a real beauty that Susan found. Here we have Fremontodendron californicum. There's a flower over here with a bee right in the middle there. You can see it has 5 stamen to go with the 5 petals. And this plant is about 20 feet tall, 30 feet tall. Its roots are about 15 feet below us, and then its crown is 15 feet above us. If we back up, you can see that it's been planted as a foundation plant next to this, 60-foot tall building adjacent to a pine and another tree. And there's a smaller one over to the left. Here we have the salvia hybrid with its strong odor. We've got our opposite leaves and square stem of the mint family, and this umbel flower with bilabiate little flowers in it with exerted stamen. The stems are purple. This is about 4 feet tall. And you can see it's a nice thick hedge of it. It can withstand full sun just like all the other sage varieties. Here we have Aeschylus californicus, California buckeye. You will remember this from the Cal Poly Arboretum. These are some of the best smelling flowers on earth. They smell like honey.
I agree.
So you'll notice there's 4 petals to the flowers. The stamen are quite a bit extruded, but then there's also 2 shorter, actually 4 shorter stamen. That's a Diadelphus stamen arrangement. The trunk is so white here. You can see how this contrast is something that could really stand out in the garden. Just that white trunk. So even when the foliage is gone, it's a really makes a statement. The flowers will develop into these long hanging seed pods in the summertime. And this plant will lose its foliage from October through February and then emerge in March. And then up behind us here, as a screen along these buildings to screen the view from these windows, we have California sycamore, but it's probably the hybrid. So London plane tree is, it's a platanus, and we'll put it on your species list. It's got this gorgeous, contrasting, flaking bark to it. And palmate leaves. Here we have a shrub that's underneath these sycamores in the shade, Philadelphus louisii, mock orange. It's in the Hydrangeaceae family, just like the Carpenteria. It has the same opposite leaf pattern, but these leaves are much more bright green. And the flower clusters are more dense at the top of each of these stems. This plant is to about 7 feet tall. It occurs on the eastern Sierra instead of the western Sierra and northern California along the coast, and it's an understory species in forests. And then we also have some blue fescue, Festuca idahoensis. Here.
I think that's glauca and this is idahoensis.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's
this is glauca.
Yeah, short.
And then this is idahoensis. My guess is this is a hybrid of idahoensis. We'll see if we can find it. Here we have Molenbergia rigens, or deer grass in flower. You can see how dense the seeds are along this inflorescence. So this is all one inflorescence here. And these you can fold off from the panicle. And the seeds are not fully developed yet. This plant's about 3 feet, 4 feet tall, including the flowers. And it forms this architectural structure. So you'll see this hillside here covered with deer grass. Very drought tolerant in the landscape.
I guess it's a riparian.
So here we have a riparian corridor that's right next to Poly Canyon Village. You'll hike up parts of this getting back to Poly Canyon. It's in the Stener Creek watershed. What I wanted to point out here is the sycamore and just how different the habitat is. So the tree is much taller. Of course, it's probably a bit older, but you can see how the bark twists. There's different fungus that interacts with the species that causes that to happen. But the London plane variety is hybridized to grow much more straight. It also can withstand microclimates with less moisture. So if you're gonna plant the native sycamore, make sure it's got year-round water availability. Here we have another native tree that can be used in the landscape that does really well and generates some real dense shade. It's Ulnus rhombifolia. So it's an alder. It's evolved in creek habitats. And so you can see it's next to a swale here that's filled with juncus. This alder has
over here, man.
Has flowers and seeds that form on structures that look like this. These seeds will turn brown as they mature.
Good. Sticky.
Here we have Cirsus occidentalis. It has very heart-shaped leaves if you fold these flat, but they do fold in half. And it's called Western Red Bud because it has these pink, gorgeous flowers in the spring. It has a gray bark, and it's planted a lot next to parking lots and buildings. Here you can see the seed pods forming on it. These are not mature yet. This is kind of a smaller tree, about 15, 10 feet tall. You can see the ones in the distance are a little bit shorter. It's a multi-branched tree. And the red bud flowers are really what's attractive about this species, as well as the foliage.
Yeah, the flowers cover the tree.
And then over next to us here, we have a ceanothus. This is the dark star ceanothus. You can see how small the leaves are here. And they are serrated, they're glossy. And then we have these bright blue, purple flowers. This plant is about 8 feet tall, but I would say it gets to 12 to 15 feet tall. The flowers are really long lasting on it. Here we have holly leaf cherry, or Prunus alyssifolia. It has very soft, flexible, serrated leaves. It ranges in size. In California chaparral, it's 3 to 8 feet high, and in riparian corridors, it's up to 30 feet tall. It has cherries that are edible that form on it as the flowers mature. And Prunus alyssifolia is the genus. It's in the Rosaceae family, which is where all of your fruit trees are going to occur. So this is a native fruit tree to California. Here we have Santa Cruz Island ironwood, Lionothamnus floribundus splendifolius. You can see from these flowers here, it's in the Rosaceae family. So it's got these delicate white flowers, kind of similar in arrangement to a toyon. The leaf structure is very interesting. It has compound leaves that are serrated to the midrib and have this pattern along them. And this tree is to 40 feet tall or so. It's called ironwood because of its bark, the bark pattern on it. With ceanothus, alum root, and manzanita, and buckwheat. Hey. Here we have Monterey cypress, Hespero cypress, Macrocarpa. If you break off the foliage, it's strongly aromatic, scented with oils in it. This occurs all along coastal California, Monterey cypress is a little controversial because sometimes it acts like an invasive species, but it's common along north-facing and west-facing slopes. Next to us, we have some more sugar bush. You can see the form of the plant here that's shorter. And then also over here, we have some Morella californica, some wax myrtle. So this is one of the largest wax myrtles I've seen. But the symmetrical nature of the foliage here, that it's kind of forming a...
rosettes almost, right?
Well, not just rosettes, but that the leaf... the foliage pattern is like a little cylinder. It's one way to tell that it's this species. Here we have a nice patch of ground cover, Salvia spathacea. These flowers are starting to dry out, but you can see these protrude about an inch and a half from the umbels at the center of this inflorescence. And then it has these triangle-shaped sticky leaves. This is a great attractor for hummingbirds and bees. All right, here we have a nice swath of plants. We have a Mexican evening primrose, Onothera speciosa, that is a perennial herb, even though it looks like an annual. We have Carex tumulicola, foothill sedge. This you will see in landscaping a lot, on streetscapes and parking lots. Here it is up here, and then also down below. You can see it's a little bit happier, greener down here where there's more moisture. And there's a field of the primrose behind me here. Up on this hillside, above the primrose is Protea. That's yellow flowering Protea. Those are from South Africa. And we have a jacaranda there. That's a purple flowering tree that gets quite large from South America. And then Muhlenbergia rigens is kind of drying out here on the edge of this patio. And then if we go up, step on this gabion. And then also, the agave has a ton of hybridized different varieties, but it's very strong and often has spikes at the end of each of the leaves, and it forms a basal rosette. We have an arbutus or strawberry tree. I think...
Unado.
Unado?
Yeah, Arbutus
Unado. Arbutus Unado. So, in this landscape, there's a mix of natives and non-natives. The Arbutus has the characteristic red bark of other plants in this genus. It has a finely toothed margin to the leaves. And then it has these kind of droplet flowers that form into these rounded spherical fruit that are edible, that turn dark red.
This looks like a pink one just from those buds.
Okay. Here we have red flowering buckwheat. Eriogonum grande variety rubescens. It has the larger leaves characteristic of Eriogonum grande with very fine tomentose white hairs on the back of the leaves. Most of the leaves are basal. You'll see they're not coming up the stem. That's another characteristic of Eriogonum grande. and the umbel flowers are very dense. This variety of buckwheat flowers quite a lot. You'll see it's very pretty next to these gray granite rocks here. And we have a number of bees visiting this plant. Here we have California milkweed, Asclepias californica. This is a host species for the monarch butterfly. Susan and I just saw one on a plant and then scurried and it left. This one occurs from the center of the state to down to San Diego, and it's mostly coastal. And it has very fine, soft hairs on all of the foliage. You'll notice how prominent the mid vein is. That's a characteristic of milkweeds. And then that there's this gentle cluster of flowers at the top. These are usually pink, white, purple, or cream colored. And the growth pattern of this milkweed here, where it's shooting up just with one stem, is typical. You'll see them in the distance here. And we've got a few other natives in this habitat. Here we have Salvia apiana. It has the very white foliage that's kind of rubbery, if you feel it, chalky and rubbery. And this is going to have the square stem that is characteristic of the mint family. And these inflorescences are opposite on this stem, with the bilabiate flowers and clusters and a single solitary spike at the top. This is used by Native Americans and herbalists as a calming incense. And we have a few other natives here. We have some toyon, Heteromeles arbutifolia, that's very bright and gorgeous, just starting to bud with its purple stems. And then we have an elderberry, Sambucus, that has a flower forming at the top. It's got its compound leaves. This one is in the Oxenidaceae family, which is a unique family. And then over here, well, Susan noticed we have these little baby yuccas here. Very spiky. Ooh, I just touched that and it was like a needle. So these will grow into the much larger Hespero yucca that we're used to. And then over here, we have the wild rye, the lamus, that you've been seeing on the hikes.
It's really good here.
And then this one is in flower. So it's starting to release pollen from the anthers. So when you see these little yellow things coming out of the flowers, that is the vehicle for the pollen. Here we have common yarrow, Achillea millifolium, in a little kind of patchy grassland here with some bark. It will take full sun like this, but it does like partial shade. This is white flowering. You can get varieties that are pink, yellow, purple, all different varieties. Ooh, and we have a monarch landing on the yarrow. Beautiful. You can plant yarrow as a grassland and mow it, which is neat to know. And that's always a nice alternative. we have Foothill Penstemon. Penstemons have a tubular flower that is bilabiate. You can split it right down the middle. It's like a face. They have two longer stamen and two shorter stamen. You'll see in here. And there's the tip of the style with the stigma down below. They have evergreen foliage with opposite leaves on it, like that. It looks a little bit like a carnation, just in the texture. And this is Margarita Bop variety of Foothill Penstemon. It's Penstemon Heterophylles. And then we have in the background here some iris Douglasiana. There's a flower hiding in here. There's a thick patch of it. And then we have Woodwardia fimbriata, chain fern. There are no spores on the back of these leaves yet. There are spores here on these ones. It's about 3 feet tall. And in the distance, we have a row of Ribes sanguineum. There's one in the corner. We'll look at up close up here. This plant is no longer in flower. And as you can tell, it's a little bit stressed. It looks like it's got full sun here, where the light is reflecting off both of the sides of this building onto this plant. And it would like a little bit more moisture and shade. And so that'll make it flower later into the season. Here we have a Sambucus or elderberry with its flat-topped umbel flowers. Very beautiful, succulent, green foliage. Here we have a low-growing Arctostaphylos. It's about 3 feet, 2.5 feet tall. And then next to it, we have a larger Arctostaphylos that's maybe 7 feet tall. You can definitely see the contrast in the habit, the growth pattern between these two plants. And we're next to California buckeye in flower right here. Down below we have a sage ground cover. Carex species in here, and Juncus. So this really low growing, bright green is the Carex, and the darker green with the rounded blade is the Juncus. Here we have lilac verbena, Verbena lilacina. Verbenas tend to flower indeterminately, so they flower from the base to the top. So these ones in the center will open last. And it has kind of finely divided foliage. Usually they're pretty glandular and glossy. It has opposite leaves. The flowers are coming off at the nodes and opposite of one another in a V pattern. And the variety is a hybrid. It is De La Mina verbena, which has darker purple flowers than the native variety. And then behind us here, we have Salvia desperado. Remember this from last week? This has white foliage from Salvia apiana and purple flowers from purple sage, Salvia leucophylla. And right now it is covered in honeybees. And it's about 5 feet tall. This is a nice thick patch. Here we have another native oak tree. This here is black oak, Quercus cologgii. It can handle drought tolerant to occasional water. It occurs in the foothills and mountains from 3,000 to 8,000 feet from Oregon to San Diego. It's a good specimen tree. The leaves turn yellow and red in the autumn. And it's named from its dark bark. This graceful tree grows from 35 to 80 feet tall. Leaves are typically 2 to 6 inches long and are deeply lobed. You see how much these are lobed almost to the mid vein, maybe 1 centimeter from the mid vein. The acorns are 1 to 1.5 inches tall. This one doesn't have mature acorns. We think it's a hybrid of the black oak. Paired with coniferous and incense cedar and red cedar, the yellow-orange foliage is a nice contrast to the green trees. And this is a relatively pest and disease-free species. You'll notice down below me here, you'll recognize these seed heads are from the Boodaloo, the blue grama grass from last week. So here we have a meadow of blue grama, and a little bit of poa as well. The blue grama has these whale gill-like seeds, inflorescences, and the pollen is starting to come out on this one. You see those dangling pieces are from the stamen. So this is right by the science building on campus.